Well, good evening. How's everybody doing? Well, welcome back to Focal Point. This is week two of three, and so Paul's back with us tonight. He's going to take us into the next series tonight, and then we'll end up next Thursday night. We'll wrap this one up. And just a reminder, we're going to take a one-week break, and then we'll come back the following Thursday, and we're going to start a six-week series on the book of Ecclesiastes. And that's going to be it's going to be a fun study. It's if you've never read the book of Ecclesiastes or never studied it in depth, it's written by Solomon at the end of his life. He's been king for 40-plus years. He's the wisest man who ever lived. He's probably the wealthiest man who ever lived. It's at the end of his life. He's looking back in his life, and he's got some significant regrets. And he's going to share them with us. And there's some great insights from Solomon about life, about how to look at life. And I was telling Paul this week, it's interesting that he used the term vanity of vanity in last week's lesson, and just how so much of this that science is trying to achieve and accomplish at the end of the day without Christ is vanity. It doesn't get you anywhere. Science is great, science is wonderful, but without Christ, it's all a vain attempt. So if you're interested, that'll be the week after we finish. We'll take a one-week break and then come back and start the book of Ecclesiastes. Now, we did something last week. You didn't know this, but if you registered for this, and most of you guys did, we did a drawing, and we drew a name, and we're going to give away one of Paul's books. We actually paid for these, Paul, so don't worry. yeah, I just grabbed one off the table in there. And so we drew a name, and the name that we drew from last week is Kyle Bland. Kyle, are you here? You got to come up and get it. You're young, I'm old, I'm not walking up there. And we're going to do this for the, we're going to give away two next week. So if you didn't register, if you're like, well, I don't know if I registered or not, what we're going to do next week is we're going to give you a little ticket, and we're going to do a drawing. You bet. And so you'll get a chance to win one of two more books next week. So tonight, we're going to take it a little bit deeper, a little bit further into this discussion. We're glad to have Paul back, and we're going to have a Q&A at the end, so don't forget, on the table, there's a little card there that tells you a number you can text questions to, and really, we encourage you to do that. Text in your questions, and we'll get to as many of them as we possibly can at the end. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to get started. Father, we thank you for this evening. Thank you for these men, and I pray that you'd be with Paul, just give him the recall he needs and confidence to say what you would have him to say. For us, Father, I pray that we would listen and that even though some of this stuff gets kind of deep at times, may we really just pay attention to what you're trying to say and what's going on around us, Father, in this world. We thank you for science. Without science, we wouldn't have medicine. We wouldn't have so many of the advancements that we enjoy. And yet, Father, we need to be careful and we need to be wise in how we approach science and how we approach all the things in the world, Father, and how the world brings ideas to the table, but they bring them without you. And so, Father, I pray as Christians that we would always view the world through the Christian lens, through the biblical lens. Father, we don't reject science, we don't ridicule it, we don't run from it, but Father, we embrace it as something that you've created, that you ordered, and that, Father, it's for our good if used wisely. So again, be with Paul, be with us, and I pray your blessings on this evening. We pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Well, it's a great privilege and honor to be back here. Kyle, if you don't read that book, I think I'm going to invite you up to speak on my behalf next week. So get to it and tell me your opinion. But it's my honor and privilege to be able to address you again. And today what we're talking about, after talking about our heart, is we're going to talk about our head. This idea of faith and reason. You know, the world thinks it's in conflict. They think to have faith, the type of faith that we have, is unreasonable. It's crazy. It's silly. So I want to explore that with you today. I want to look at how are we able not only to commit our heart, but to commit our head. To be rational, to be mindful, to pursue that which is true, that which is good, that which is beautiful. Now, I am an engineer and I am a tech guy, but I have to admit, I made one fatal mistake in coming here today. I left my cell phone plugged into its charger and walked out the door in that rainstorm today. So I don't even have one of the props that I was going to carry with me. But I'm in my early 50s. When I was back as an engineer doing my electronics studies in the early mid 80s, there was this supercomputer, and you may have heard about it. It was called the Cray supercomputer. When I was going to school one generation ago, it was the biggest, fanciest computer. I don't know exactly where it was stored. I imagine Washington, D.C. or some government, you know, bomb-proof building, so it could do all the calculations so the government would know exactly how to do everything and win the wars or whatever they had to do. And I knew it was used also to number crunch things like astronomy or big complicated mathematical problems or whatever was going on at the day to do. And I don't even know how big a Cray supercomputer it is. I just knew that when I went to school, it was like way big, probably as big as this room, consisting of pile after pile of machines all interconnected. And you've probably seen some of the movies or images of what computers looked like back in the day and can imagine what it looked like a generation ago. The Cray supercomputer, when I was getting an engineering degree, the fastest. And do you know how fast it went? About 250 megahertz. Now you might be like, well, Paul, I don't even know what a megahertz is. 250 million operations in 1 second. But if you have your cell phone, pull it out right now, and you have something like an Apple or a Samsung, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, you know, anything within the last couple of years, you have probably at least a 1 gig or 2 gig processor, something that is 4 to 8 times in its calculations per second as the Cray supercomputer. So what you're telling me is since I got my degree, you all now, personally in your own possession, own something 5, 10 times faster than the computer that I was looking up to as an electronic engineering student. Now, at that time, there was only 1, 2, 3, 5, 10, I don't know how many Cray supercomputers, but very few, because they cost a ton of money. And so only people like the government would have them, or probably places like MIT or NASA or whoever, but just a handful. But do you know how many cell phones there are right now? There's about 5 billion. Okay, there's about 7 billion people, about 5 billion. So even if you're poor, even if you live way off, even if you're not making as much money as we do here in the United States, you know, the upper 5%, you probably have a cell phone. So do you know what that means? That means there's 5 billion people carrying around things in their pocket that are 5 or 10 times faster than a Cray supercomputer when I was studying to get my engineering degree. How out of date am I? But see, that's what's going on. The future is going to be something like that. That not just 2 times, 10 times, 100 times, but I just told you in my lifetime, probably similar to yours, one generation, billions of times of more computational power spread around. And you know what? It's like super cheap. I know you think it's expensive when you go down to the phone store and get one, but you are getting the 1985 version of Cray supercomputers. Think about if they marketed them that way. How incredible that is. And I think all this technology is expanding because of innovation. And I think there's a couple important things that are going on. The first one is related to digital transformation, where the cost of making a transistor, the basic on-off switch that's inside of electronics, has dropped. Back in the day, without us getting specific on the day, to build 1 million transistors would cost several hundred dollars. Now, it just costs pennies. It went from hundreds of dollars per million to pennies. A dramatic shift in orders of magnitude. What about how much you can store? I can remember when I got out of school, there was the Commodore 64. A page of paper takes about 2K. Commodore 64, 32 pages of information you could hold. What? I can't even load up ESPN on my phone with that type of stuff. You have tremendous expansion in what's going on with the cost per gigabyte of data. It has gotten so cheap, and you can have so much that to you and I, it's virtually free. None of us are really running around paying that much for memory like we used to back in the day. And it goes so fast. Your phones, your computers become out of date. It just process faster and faster. So I think this digital transformation of being able to increase the speeds and the capacities and the storage by orders of magnitude will continue to happen. And so, whether you're old or young, it's going to go up hundreds, thousands, millions, billions, trillions in the future. I think that's logical. You know what else has happened in technologies besides all this digital things making it so we can have so much? Is things have become more dynamic in terms of our ecosystems. Everybody can work together. When I started 30 years ago, I showed up to work, and the only people I interacted with were people who sat by me and drank coffee with me. And, you know, hey, Sometimes I'd pick up the phone. That was a real big thing to talk to somebody else in a different division. Like, woo, they're located in Phoenix or Boston or wherever. To do some cooperation with them, to receive a fax from them. What's going on? Now, we live in a world where all of us can instantaneously communicate and work with anybody anywhere in the world at real time. And it's normal. It's normal. You're all doing it. Instantaneously, distance has shrunk to essentially nothing. And so it allows us then to move from just a few people that we get to interact with essentially anybody. We just have to have a reason for connecting with them. What about things like open platforms? Do you remember that when you first saw that? When like, what do you mean this app? I load it on my phone and then I can like use it and everybody else is using it and it's cool, convenient things for me. And people are just gonna keep loading this up with convenient things for me. Or they're gonna build ways that I can communicate that's in common with everybody else. So like, wait, everybody else has got email and it's all kind of universally connected. And I just have this one email address and anybody else can find me and talk to me and I can see what they're saying to me instantaneously. See, the world's gotten dynamic and open, and that's all a result of technology. And I think another thing has happened is that because of these great expansions and reductions in prices and proliferation is that boundaries have dropped within industries or businesses. And what I mean by that is everybody's impacted by it. You can't stand in whatever industry or calling you have and say, oh, we're not impacted by that. You are. No matter what you're doing, no matter what field you're in, we're all working on some type of similar systems. And so what that does is it cross-fertilizes between businesses. It's common in our lifetime to be able to switch in and out of different businesses, where in the past we might have a specialty and just stay there because it was defined by what's going on. Now it's much more important that you know how to use that, but who you are as an individual is what matters. What can you bring to the table? And so I think that all these changes have wrought a tremendous change in our society and what's going on. And I think that technology being so successful has made it so that it's very easy to say that it's very reasonable, that it's very rational. It's very easy to see all the progress that's been made by science, by technology, and to go, that's it. You know what? I don't see those type of growth things happening at my church. Our baptisms aren't up by 1,000,000,000%. Our conversions aren't that successful. It's not that easy to do that. And so I think people lose this connection with faith. I think what's happened is that there's convergence, you may want to write this down, of NBIC, nanotechnology, which we'll talk about today and next week, nanotechnology, biotechnology, life sciences, information technology, probably where you are most hit, how you use a computer, how do you use the phone. And behind the scenes, the greatest area of interest in research right now is cognitive sciences. Scientists looking at the brain, looking at it, believing it's like a computer, that a computer is in one sense an emulation of the human brain. What can we do with computers that are brain-like? And what can we do with our brains that are computer-like? What are the connections and correlations? I think this convergence of NBIC will be dramatic for all of us. And we're going to talk about that today and next week. Now I want to give you very simply what I think the thesis is. If you go, Paul, well, help me to understand what should be the big picture of how am I supposed to look at this. I want to propose the following to you. I want to propose that we as Christians believe that there's God as creator and that he's made us as man highest in that creation, Genesis 1. It's in the image of him that we've been made. And because of that, we're called image bearers. Jesus Christ is an image bearer. He came as a man, perfectly human. He also comes as God, bearing the image not only of man, but of God. Because you and I are image bearers, I want to make the claim to you that our God, who's created everything, for everybody outside of this room, they also have something in common with you. They are image bearers, whether they accept it or not. They bear the image of God. They're made in his image. They are rational, creative, intelligent beings on a whole host of scales, normally. Because we're made in God's image, I want to say to you that we're responsible to God. We are responsible to God. He's given us the creation mandate where we can go out and do things. And you know what we're going to do with our hands? We're going to create, and let's call those things that we create, one of them, technology. So it is awesome that we have cell phones. That is awesome. That is glorious. That is part of who we are, imaging God, using our minds to create awesome, awesome things. But because we're made by God, we have a responsibility to Him in how we employ that technology. So I want to say to you that as image bearers, all mankind, no matter where you live, is responsible for their use of technology. Back to Him because we're image bearers. And I think many people use the technology incorrectly and irresponsibly, and that's really where we have issue. Because God's communicated to us what He means by being responsible. So I think I'd have a lot of agreement here about the issue of life. About what does it mean to be created in His image, and what does that mean we're supposed to do once life has been created here on earth? Jesus Christ came in a womb, fertilized in Mary by the Holy Spirit. We care about life because God, the image of God Himself and the image of man, came incarnate. Our anthropology, our Christian understanding says that we're supposed to be responsible, we're supposed to be good, we're supposed to be holy, and we're distinct. And God also says to us, because we're social beings, we're supposed to do something that I'm going to super simplify. Basically, the call of the Bible socially is to promote what is good, per God, and avoid that which is evil. Promote what God says is good, and avoid or abstain or get away from that as evil. So when we look at technology and we go, hey, what am I supposed to do on this issue? I want to propose to you that I think we're supposed to do things that are good for God while abstaining or avoiding things that are evil. You know, we live in a world that is anti-social. They think they're social. But to be social means you actually care and love about others. The perfect example of that is Jesus Christ, that who we're called to emulate. But see, the world hates Jesus. You know why? Because their focus is not on others, as Jesus was, sacrificing Himself for their very sins, but their focus is on themselves over others. And I think what we find when we look at people using technology irresponsibly is the focus turns towards themselves as primary. And it turns away from what can I do for God, who I image bear, and what should I be doing for others. And so I want us to take and use that lens about how we're supposed to look at things. Because the culture hates God and loves self and wants to have autonomy, they're willing to do anything with technology apart from this understanding that we have. Do good for God, avoid evil. See, we're part of nature, but God says we're something more. You're distinct, as we talked about last week, because you're made in His image. And see, our machines, robots, AI, anything like this, can never be moral before God because they're lacking this imago Dei, this relationship that God wants to have for all eternity, which each and every one of us, of which Christ incarnate proves. But we live in a world where our culture is to make, and so we make technology. This technology is nothing but tools. It's tools to help us to get to properly ordered ends or goals. That's good. Let's find a way to cure cancer. Let's find a safer way to drive our vehicles so that we don't have collisions at 60 miles an hour. We are called to be priests that worship God. But I find many of my colleagues and friends not interested in this God, not interested in worshiping Him, because their eyes and their attention and their focus is on worshiping science itself, on something that's produced so much good, but is just the result of these hands. As awesome as it is, it's a manufacturing by human hands. You know, I'm a sinner, fallen, reconnected with God through Jesus Christ. And I live in a digital world, a world where I'm super connected. Hey, how many Facebook friends do you have? 10, 100, 500, thousands? You know, we would all look at our Rolodex. Well, that's old school, just our contact in our phone, and go, man, look at all those names, look at how connected I am. Look at how many people I know and I've touched on. But really, since digital has come, we've become in a manner relationally disconnected. That those names that you have in your phone or on your email don't mean you are personally influential in their life. Particularly as it pertains to God, of whom you follow. And emotionally and spiritually, the same things happen. Because we are so isolated, we reach out and think like, yeah, that text got it covered. Just told me, yep, think praying for you. Got it done, yeah. Is that really the same weight as showing up at the hospital? Is that really the same weight as being with somebody to hear them for 2 hours? But yet, we go, yeah, it's done, man. So we can be digitally connected, wonderful, but still live in a fallen world where we disconnect ourselves from relationships emotionally and spiritually. And so I ask us, what's happened to us, you personally, over the last year, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years? Have you gotten deeper and closer to people? Or do you use this technology to go, I got it covered. Everything's checked off and done. We need to be responsible to God. And one of those areas of responsibility is to people. People are messy. People are hard. As a church, that's what we're in the business to do, is to reach people with the good news. Hey, I have in front of you a handout that Ken was very helpful in putting together for me. Ken, if you would show those terms for me. Now, I'm not going to go through this list, but I give this to you, and I'm not saying it's perfect. I'm not claiming it's from Webster's. I'm just trying to give you one phrase, a little something to hold on to, about what I think that these terms might mean for us and how we should think about them. I welcome you to think on them as well. And I want to talk as we go through this about our mind and these ideas as we use these words in here about what that means. What does it mean when we say we have faith? What does it mean when it says we're being rational, which the world says you Christians aren't rational? What does it mean to have faith over reason? Or reason over faith? I want to talk to you about that today, about how we're to process that. I want to point out that science, this great good that we've been talking about, that gives us things like technology, as you'll see there, is an empirical inductive method for obtaining opinion and knowledge. And what that means is, empirical means it's done through the senses. Taste, touch, sight, hearing, things of that sort. And it's inductive, meaning you use your mind, you use your reason to go, hey, because that's going on, I think this is the relationship. And so you venture a thought on it. And you could be right. And science is repeatable and observable, meaning somebody else in a faraway land can look at the same thing and they should come up with the same results. And if they're different, they can chat to you about them, about why they might be different and what's going on and what the theories are. But science only relies on the five senses. And what we're going to talk about is something bigger. Something that not only takes the five senses, but takes all of our being. Faith. Let's look at what faith is. Faith is an assent or an approval or agreement to a statement about reality. The Bible defines it as the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction, the knowing of things not seen. Automatically, by definition, faith is not empirical. It does not mean it's not reasonable. It does not mean it cannot be rational. It's knowing something, approving it. We believe that God has communicated in His Word and in His person, empirically showing up on earth, on a cross in Jerusalem, on a date that we celebrate as Good Friday, dying on behalf of mankind. 3 days later, raising up empirically. Here's the thing. I can't go back and do an experiment on it. Yet, I contend, I argue, I plead with you that that is truth. I know I'm relying on others who are there to tell me about that, but I trust them. I do. I trust that word given to me, received by me. There was a date when I did not. But it's not empirical. I want to contend that faith, the way we should see it, if you go to the next one, should be informing our reason. In other words, they're not in conflict, but the way we should look at things is similar to this road sign. Faith is on top, and it informs our reason so that every day, as an engineer, or a husband, or a pastor, or as a father, I use both of these. But it's my faith, something bigger and broader than just through my five senses that I receive through science, that informs me and allows everything that comes into my purview, so whether we're talking about astronomy or the nature of man, I can be informed and have a belief that I assent to and express my opinion and knowledge to you rationally, reasonably. Come, let us reason together. Now I want to take a turn. I want to move into some of these specific topics and introduce them to you. Maybe you know them already. If you would, Ken, would you go to the genetics? I told you that this NBIC is happening like crazy. You know, my wife, as a gift, got this 23andMe. Who's got one of those? Who's done one of those? It's like every day I see it advertised and around. I'm like, hey, Diana, you got to do that so I know who I'm married to. So I'm like, get on that. I'm talking about that. So she's got it sitting over there where what you can do is put your saliva sample in and send it away. And about 2 weeks later, it's going to come back. I'm expecting it to tell me lots of Irish for her. Maybe not. You know, that would blow my mind, but oh, lots of Irish or whatever on there. But they can look into your DNA. There's so much science going on right now, playing around with our DNA. And that's cool. I hope they can heal diseases and fix things and do what you and I would say are good. But hey, maybe you heard the news last week about this boy named Alfie. You hear about him? Now, Alfie is born with problems, man. I don't even know them all, but problems. And what I saw the world do, in my opinion, is over here. Hey, Alfie, you're defective. Hey, Alfie, whatever all this stuff is messed up. It's kind of junky. You're kind of not worth it. Was that true? Do you know that over 90% of the babies that are diagnosed as Down syndrome are aborted? Doesn't matter if you're a Christian or not. They're aborted. The doctor says to you, hey, husband and wife, you don't want this. Then in countries like the Scandinavian countries and Iceland and that type of stuff, it's essentially zero born. Zero. So we live in a world that Down syndrome, a defect to who we are, to our 23andMe-ness, is seen as a deficiency because you're biological matter. Nothing but. Why would you want to go through all that time and expense and take care of that child? Now let me ask you, what do you think the Bible teaches in Christ? What do you think the gospel tells us they went and did when he saw the hurting, the infirmed, the lame, the sick? Is that what we're doing with our medicine? Are we always helping? Or are we using it as a screen to go, this is how I want to spend my resources? Maybe you've heard of this. Have you heard of this thing, what genetics called CRISPR? Now, I like that acronym because it's easy for me to remember, but boy, wait till I give you this word. It's complicated. It stands for Clustered Regularly Interspaced Short Palindromic Repeats. See, you got to be a scientist to understand that, right? It's complicated, even when it's in an acronym. But to boil it down, to make it simple, what CRISPR means is we can get into the genes and we can do something very similar to unzipping them, taking them, opening them up, going in and snipping out parts that we want or don't want, and moving them and re-zippering them back in. What used to cost many hundreds of thousands of dollars and have to be done in a big expensive medical place has recently, over the last few years, been reduced in price to something on the order of $1,000. So that I can drive 5 miles down the road in any direction and find medical facilities that have that equipment and can do that. So what that means is you don't have to be the big boy with all the money to do this type of research or this type of work. You can be any medical or biological facility and do this. Now there's tremendous amounts of things that you can do. Hey, There's a problem in this genetic code here. This is a marker that tells us there's going to be cancer or a defect or always this issue. What if we could fix that? Okay. But because you can unzip it, you can imagine that people want to insert different things. Hey, make me like a sex symbol, and everybody that comes from my family, just be awesome. Build my child so that he's automatically going to be the first round draft choice of the NFL. You could do that because you would put the genes in that says muscle strength or speed or those type of things. Or intelligence. Or beauty. It opens up a world. But you know, you just don't move DNA from humans because there might be pigs or sheep or cows that have something that, boy, I wonder what it would do over here. Maybe it'll help because they don't seem to get this disease. So where we've been getting it, let's insert some of that and see what happens. Or it's not that I just want to eliminate disease. I'd like to be faster, more horse-like. The door is open. Do not fool yourself because you do not hear that it is not happening. It is. It is happening. It is being worked on. Let's take a look at this next slide on transhumanism. We talked about this a little. It's about being able to choose what kind of form we're going to have. How can we change ourselves? It's the intellectual and cultural movement that affirms the possibility and desirability of fundamentally improving our human condition through applied reason, especially by developing and making widely available technologies to eliminate aging and to greatly enhance our human intellectual, physical, and psychological capacities. Who will we be? Many want us to morph and move in to machines. Many want the machines to replace us because we're inefficient, biologically subject to irrationality, death, and disease, where the machine can be made to live for a long time. They want to, in one sense, have an immortality of the body. It's funny because as Christians, we already have immortality. See, the big spiritual thing is going to go on between immortality as we understand it and the immortality that the world understands, which is just related to the body. So coming is the clash, the culture clash between infinite immortality of the body, zero regard for the soul. You know what? I want you all to live another 10, 20, 30 years from now. The Bible already speaks about a lot of old guys. The issue isn't how long we live. But the Bible does say, you shall die. Why? Because you're a sinner. And then only one of two things happen. Either that's real, either my knowledge is correct, or it's not. Either I live and just be reasonable like the world, or I let the faith communicated by my Creator telling me who I am tell me how I'm to reasonably live in a world that's gone mad. What about IoT, the Internet of Things? Have you seen this? The Internet of Things is the internet that we have now, but in the future, we'll have sensors on our watches or in different places. You'll have sensors on all these doors, just like when you check in right now, you have to go touch the panel to do that. You won't have to do that. You'll just cross the threshold, and it will say, Joe Smith has entered CCBC. And then it'll tell when you leave. Automatically. Cool. Don't have to do any of that stuff. Convenient. Flexible. Technology for good, collecting information. When I go into Starbucks, it automatically, because Paul Galata walks in, goes, Paul, hey, this is on sale, your favorite drink or whatever, and tells me right up there when I'm standing there, because there'll be a sensor that when I'm standing in a certain position in line, what I'm supposed to do and how I'm supposed to interact with the person in front of me based on my preferences. But all this data can create problems, just like happened with Facebook. Because ultimately, everybody will have this data on you, and they could do something like Christians. Boy, they are very anti-American. If they're Christian, let's make sure we don't give them anything from the government. Stop those checks. Or don't let them in for medicine. Or don't do this. Or don't do that. The Internet of Things makes it so that our data is held in community by all and makes it so that great things can happen in convenience, but also can be subjected to abuse. If you need the next slide, please. If you take reason only, there's a philosopher from New Mexico State that Ken was reading about that basically said, virtue is genetic. Virtue is genetic. The Bible says otherwise. I want to share with you, before we move on, this history of ideas. You see down on page one there, that in pre-modernity, up until about 1500, no matter where you were at in what I'll call Western society, that means Israel to England, all those type of places, there was no dichotomy between faith and reason. It was seen to be like two different sides of the coin, just like this sign that I have up there. They go together. There is no differentiation on page two between philosophy, science, and mathematics. You do both. The world is ordered. And it's not that they weren't pre-scientific. Have you ever looked at like the Egyptian pyramids? Are you telling me that they're building any buildings that will stand and last like that here? No. Everything falls apart and decays, even when they make it awesomely. It's not that they didn't know what pi was. They knew exactly. They knew exactly. The issue was there was not a large enough accumulated base. So you know what you have to do? When the only thing you do is have man, you got to go, dude, 10,000 of us got to walk over down the Nile here and get this big stone. You know how much this stone weighs? 10 tons. Now we got to move it 20 miles across the desert over here where the Pharaoh wants it. Oh, can we just pull it on a rope? No. So we'll invent some ingenious ways to do it. Things that you can't even imagine. How did they do that? Look at where that's at. Yeah, that's a lot of sweat. It's also a lot of thought. It's not that they're not scientific. They just didn't have any trucks. They didn't have any bulldozers. They didn't have any, you know, there's nothing. So it only comes down to you and a bunch of guys, and you gotta brute force it. It's only the accumulation over time that gives us this exponential that we're living in. And then we come to the modern age. 15, 1600s. And you know what? Europe really felt burned by the Catholic Church. Us Protestants, hey, we go, yeah, you got some problems. But they really felt burned. You thought we were the center of everything. But we're third rock from the sun. So, I will doubt everything. And so that becomes the prevailing culture. Doubt everything. And so you know what that means? Because the Pope, rightly so, and the Catholic Church, rightly so, are wrong on science things and on theology, I would argue. Because they're wrong, the whole world becomes skeptical. And so with that, the Bible and Jesus Christ and all these things start to get jettisoned. Why should I believe that? Because I can't touch it. Jesus isn't here. I can't see him. And so science from Francis Bacon on, an empirical method to observe that is open to anybody anywhere in the world saying, I claim foul. That's not the way it is. Becomes truth, the only type of knowledge. And it's thought that it would replace superstition, things like Christianity. Fable. That's not based in history. Would become the argument. Why would God allow an earthquake in Lisbon and 20,000 people die, Voltaire says. You fools, he does not control the world because he doesn't care. Because he doesn't exist. So it's science, 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 science. And then we get to the 20th century. And you get World War I, you get World War II, you get machine guns, atom bombs, mustard gas, people killing themselves. And the world becomes in despair, going, you know what? Even though I'm doing all this science, I'm no better. I'm not improved in any ways. And so the claim is that science is just another will to power. That the scientists are just a group like any other. And they push against objective truth. They push against objective truth. And so we live in a world that's like that now. A world that has replaced faith with reason. A world that's very scientific, yet lives in despair. Let's talk about science and reason. So I heard this on the radio a couple days ago. In 2014, Facebook had two genders, male, female. Hey, that exactly corresponds to my understanding of the world and the biblical account and everything I knew since 1964 when I was born. Then people protested and said, you intolerant bigots. And so they did not make it three, they did not make it four, but they changed from two to 58. 58 genders. Now it is 2018. They got yelled at because 58 was not enough. You get to write your own gender, your own nouns, your own adjectives. So it is infinite. Now let me ask you, is that scientific? We go to our genetics here, and I go, dude, XY chromosome. I don't know anything about 23andMe except XY chromosome. That's what me and my wife talked about when we got pregnant is, hey, Paul, I wonder, did you give me an X or Y chromosome? Well, I don't know. Don't know who the winner of that race was. But I do know that was the only two choices, meaning I never expected and said, well, we got a lot of baby names we got to do. I got to come up with at least 58, depending on what comes out. No, I got this one and this one. And everybody still does it the same. Unless you got an agenda. Because that's what's going to happen. That's the output that's coming out scientifically. Even if you want to take and deny it. We live in a world that says science, 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 reason, 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 but is irrational. It is irrational at a level that you can argue at 23andMe, even though you don't know anything about genetics. I want to open it up at this time to questions and answers.
So this is a multiple part question.
I'll try to keep track. hope only two parts.
So in the not so distant past, it was once unethical to examine corpses in order to gain medical knowledge, but is now considered acceptable. So in our quest to further learn about us as humans by tampering with genetics, the genetic manipulation, will it become acceptable with the generations to come, and where exactly is that line drawn between what is right and what is wrong, and what can we avoid, or what can we do to avoid crossing it?
Yeah, I know that already right now in labs across the world, there's a ton of non-Christianity and it's anything goes. And so specifically places like China and other places like that have an anything goes attitude. The idea being, in many of those cultures, of to them, they see that as the potential to improve their race, and their race alone, not the human race, kind of a nationalistic type of thing, and to use that as a competitive advantage. That can be for things like learning, that could be things like Olympics. You've seen to what lengths people will go to win a gold medal and those type of things. Within our own country, I think there's plenty of improper evil on that. I think it's very hard to draw the boundaries on there. My first order, again, would be this do good, avoid evil. Curing disease and things of that sort, I think is an admirable, noble type of things to do. When you go, what are we to do in terms of enhancement and those type of things? I think those type of things we should have discussion. So in other words, should it be good and feasible for me to have 5 more points of IQ? Would we like to have that? We certainly feed ourselves to, you know, try to have that, to have good health. We run and exercise and do a whole variety of things to have maximum type of things. I think it's important, though, to make sure that we do not ever lose the distinction that we are more than material. And I think most of these discussions only are materialistic. And so what I would always do as a first order is to go, are we talking about the just material on that or spiritual? When we enter into that spiritual domain and talk about that, then we can talk. But I always want to first handle that issue. I am not qualified to answer all those type of things, meaning they're super complicated and bigger. One of the things, though, that I would just say across the board is I don't like the idea of people being a means to an end and that type of stuff, kind of this raw thing of all processing. So, for example, one thing is stem cells. You know that they get stem cells most often right now from aborted fetuses. I do not stand that that's good to use those type of stem cells. Not because I don't like stem cells, because I don't like abortion, because I don't stand for abortion. There are other ways to get stem cells that I'm totally for. So, if in the future I was able to do this into a petri dish and they go, great, we got some stem cells, that we can turn into things to help people, I'd probably be very much for that. Because no human beings, no Imago Deis, no image bearers were done that way. Now, of course, I'm grossly oversimplifying in that type of stuff, but that's where I'm saying if I was in charge of things, I'd be like, let's explore this and let's put those things off to the side. You can see in our culture right now, there's many states that are fighting over the issue of abortion with things related to can you sense a heartbeat and all that type of stuff, and you can see the resistance that the world has to, again, science. It is science. It is science when there's life. The Bible defines it based on Jesus Christ. Theologically, he became incarnate. He did not show up on the scene, 30-year-old. He came in a virgin birth from day zero. There was a point in time where Mary wasn't pregnant, and then she was pregnant. And similar things were happening with John the Baptist. Not that he was touched through the Holy Spirit, but he knew in the womb. Meaning God put Mary and Elizabeth in physical contact, yet there is no way the babies know, yet that is recorded. So do you think that's recorded so that 2,000 years we don't know what we're supposed to think about some of these things? Why is that detail in there? There is nothing that I did in the 9 months of my wife where recorded, hey, the baby kicked. You don't have any of those written down. Nothing. Nothing. No person has ever written down baby kicked. That is written so that we understand what's going on. That those are two important individuals. What does it mean about how we're supposed to view the womb? And who's supposed to protect and defend? And I believe that Christ wants us on this side do good, not over here doing evil. So that would be me.
Okay. Is there an appropriate use of genetic manipulation?
Again, I think there can be for certain things, so that if we were to do something to eliminate Down syndrome on that without killing the baby and that type of stuff, if you could go in and fix slot 162 or whatever it was, some slot out of a zillion slots and go on that, I would want that to be done properly and ethically and those type of things, meaning in a manner that does not harm other life or degrade the dignity and destiny of humans.
All right, we're going to jump to artificial intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
What are the dangers of AI, and what are some potential consequences that we don't see coming?
Hey, buy my book. That's what it's all about. But I think to make it short, I think some of them is AI, by and large, lives in a material world. Because it's a creation by humans, the answers of whatever it computes and comes up with, ultimately, even if the machine's way smarter than people, got programmed by sinners. And so what my book is basically arguing for is God, infinitely intelligent, is way beyond perfect, holy, just, righteous, all the things that we claim as Christians, in a manner that no machine can ever be. Even if the machine is fancier, smarter, quicker calculating, can beat me at chess, beat me at Go, get my Uber automatically, think before me, tell me what the answers are in Greek, you know, okay. But you are not like my God. And you will never come up with those answers, such that, like I said, you can go home and you can go talking to your Alexa, and I know that's not super AI or anything, and say, hey, who's Jesus Christ? Is man a sinner? What do you think about abortion? See what is said back to you. The answers will be things like, Jesus, he's a great prophet. He's a famous prophet. Or, well, that's not correct. That is a reduction of who he is. Go ask. Again, I know that's not it, but the machines, the greatest machines we have now do not come up with the proper answers because you don't get there just by knowing everything on Google and Wikipedia. Because the answer always comes out that there is no true religion. The answer will come, truth is based on da, 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 da. Ask it. It will never come to the same conclusions that the Bible leads you to. So let's be biblically informed and stick with what God has told us.
Speaking of AI, is singularity actually possible, and is it something to be scared of?
I'm not scared of it. I think many are concerned with that. I understand the idea of the singularity, for those who don't know, is this belief that one day we'll create such systems that they'll be so powerful that they basically will take over from humans and be running so fast, so smartly, that we can never catch up to them. So that whether it's one machine or the machines, as a fabric network, are operating. If you've ever seen the movie Space Odyssey 2001, there's a computer called HAL, and the astronauts are going on a voyage, and unbeknownst to them, he has a different agenda. That is not the singularity, but it's that type of concept, that the machine, so to speak, becomes smarter than everybody else on the other side. So many scientists think that because they think that calculations only is what's important. Now, I just told you at the beginning of this lecture, the beginning of this talk, in my lifetime, about all these transistors and chips and all, okay, yeah, billions and billions times more. Do I think the world is any better? In a certain sense, yes, I can catch an Uber cab very fast, right? That sense better. Not better in terms of my heart. Not better in terms of my love for God and the creation. All those type of things. We are still flawed anthropologically without Christ. That will never change.
What are the ethical limits of cloning? Are we to approve of such technology?
I don't approve of them, but I know, again, science is going to want to go there at some times. I like the God-ordained method of let me get my wife and let's get busy. So if you're with me on that, I'm like, oh. Hey. I also recognize you might be infertile or have issues and that type of stuff. And me and my wife, when we got together, you know, I didn't know anything about where she was at or where I was at about how we were going to do that. But I said, and we talked about when we got married, what are we going to do if you or I are barren on this? What are we going to do? And I said, well, we're going to adopt like crazy on this and whatever God puts in our ways. And I think that's a very wonderful and awesome Christian response, because the world needs us. It needs us to mother and father those that are here. I totally understand the idea of wanting your own child. I know for myself, I have four girls. Man, I was Mr. Sports, I was Mr. Like, I wanted a boy. So they kept coming out, and I wasn't getting a boy. Maybe you've had something like that where it doesn't work. Because I, you know, scientist that I am, I go, it's 50-50, then 50-50, that's 25% chance, then 12.5% chance, 6% chance. Hey, how did this happen to me? God knows what he's doing. Okay? God, even though I say, oh, I want to be a football coach and baseball coach and do all these other things with boys, you have girls. Okay. You're in control, God. I don't like cloning just because, again, of these. I think it tears at the fabric of what we believe biblically.
All right, so this is the final question for the night. How do we discern when it's acceptable to use what technology has provided us with medical advancements, and when are we going against God's will?
Again, submit yourself to God, the Bible, you know, your church council, all those type of things. The best advice I can give you is do good, avoid evil. Now, here's the thing. I don't know what it is because I don't know your context or your situation. Call your pastors or, you know, your friends and all that type of stuff and follow what you understand. Like I said, I think myself and others like me that care deeply about Christ can help you on that. That doesn't mean we're perfect and flawless and infallible on that type of thing. But I think what happens is God allows you to come to an understanding about what you're supposed to do, about what is good and what is not. There are many things that I do. There are many things that I do that I go, since I don't know God, I'm going to try to do this. I'm going to try to do this. I know others say I have freedoms, or what, but I'm going to try to do this just because of my things. So do your best. God understands who you are. Your condemnation is not ever based off your ethics. Your condemnation is only if you are not putting your faith and trust in Christ. If you are not putting your faith and trust in Christ, place your faith and trust in Christ. That's about your medical procedures, about are you having kids, what you're supposed to do with having kids, all that type of stuff. Place your faith and trust in Christ. God will direct and guide you. Any mistakes that you have, hey, I get it. We all make mistakes. Proceed forward. Peter denied the Christ after he resurrected. Okay? I do stupid things too. But do your best to follow God's will, God's Bible, His character, His essence, His nature of what He's revealed to us. And I think that'll guide you very well.
All right, Paul, I was just kidding. We have one more question.
Okay.
Okay, so in this postmodern world, where currently and socially there seems to be a lack of belief in no absolute truth and more of a belief in a personal truth, where do you see this thinking evolving, or where do you see this going?
I'm not really good at predicting the future, but I think we live in a society, because we don't have absolute truths, everything's open, so I think we have a very contentious society. I think that it's going to get duked out for a while. Normally what happens, the course of history, when things are contentious, is somebody strong steps into the void, whenever that is, and says, this is the way it is, to restore order. That goes back 2,500 years ago to Plato, wrote about it, and kind of talked about the cycle of how things rise and fall. On that normally what happens is things go through seasons, and as soon as there's a tipping point reached, people flock, society moves in a direction that says, hey, we can't live that way anymore, so they start to accept or give rise or credence to a different way. So I think we're going to be more and more fractured, and then something, and again, I'm not here to tell you what, that will pull us together to unify us, whether good or bad, but something that might be stronger, in whatever all that means, more singular on that, because I see us being more diverse in that type of stuff. So this atomic way ultimately will come back on itself and merge back towards center. That, again, that's the normal thing that you see. But I'm not making any predictions in time or any of that. I have no skills or giftings in that. But again, no worries. We're in Christ.
All right, Paul, thank you again for joining us this week.